Hey everyone, I'm Kaitlyn Barnard.
And I'm Victor Gamov.
In this series, we chat with software developers and technology leaders to tackle your biggest API connectivity challenges.
Stay tuned to this episode for tools, tactics, strategies that will help you to take your distributed architectures to the next level. Let's begin.
Today, I'd like to welcome Grant McKeen, CTO at IntegrationWorks, as well as Jono White, who's also in pre-sales at IntegrationWorks. So Grant and Jono are here today to talk to us about open banking, as well as the Banking Industry Architecture Network, or BIAN, as well as Kong Gateway and how they fit together very well. Grant, can you start off by giving us a quick rundown of what BIAN actually is and how it relates to common connectivity challenges?
Yeah, sure can. Thanks. BIAN is a not-for-profit organization. I'll just state that at the start. And they've created an exhaustive set of services for the banking and finance industry. Now, these resources are freely available. Member organizations of BIAN contribute to these, and they're made of the top banking and finance services firms in the world. So they're a freely available resource, as I said before, very useful, and they're maintained and released just about on a yearly cycle at the moment. So open banking is about opening up the banking services that are provided by the large banks to third-party providers, application developers, and end users. This is mostly created through regulation in most countries and geographies, and it's designed to really create an atmosphere where third-party providers can come in and create more functionality, better solutions for the end user and end consumer than what banks are currently providing in the market. There's still quite a reliance on banks. So open banking interfaces are very important to give them the standards, compliance, regulation, and risk mitigation that they require, while still being very open and composable, which application developers and end users require for their solutions.
Yeah, so open banking is a way to have banks provide a set of standardized interfaces to allow service providers and third parties into their banking services. And BIAN itself is a group of experts and service providers in the financial industry. And what they've done is model the complete set of banking capabilities into an exhaustive list of what they've called service domains. And for each service domain, they're starting to create open API specifications for the interaction with those service domains. And that supports the open banking initiative by providing those standardized interfaces. Yeah, and BIAN is such a large landscape of services. They've literally created a service for every capability that a bank could reasonably be provided to perform. But no one bank, unless it's a huge multinational, is going to implement every service domain. So we really need a solution that allows the consumer to pick and choose which domains to implement. And because BIAN have chopped their capabilities into such well-defined bounded contexts, deploying the service domain of your choice is key to being able to start implementing BIAN without needing to boil the whole ocean and deploy everything.
So what exactly is the problem that this solves?
When you're dealing with interoperability in the banking and finance area, it's a very complex area fraught with a lot of danger, failed projects, and large vendors as well. BIAN looks to solve the problem of creating simplicity from complexity in the banking and financial services industry. It's done this by decomposing the various capabilities of a bank from an exhaustive list put together from its members of some of the largest banks and financial service providers in the world. And it decomposes these into service domains and then further into API specifications that are free and open to use. These provide an asset where application developers, banks, third-party providers can download these assets and create solutions based around them that are intrinsically interoperable. The interoperability that this provides means that there's a lower cost of effort and time to create solutions in this industry that are open banking.
Yeah, so really it's looking at creating a standardized model for banks to use. Banking architecture traditionally was very process-oriented, and this caused quite a few issues As the processes within a bank really expanded, the architecture became very tangled and brittle. But by taking it back to the capabilities that a bank needs to offer and then modeling the process as an interaction between these service domains made it a lot easier to model.
That's why we created the Kobi CLI, was to create and manage those open banking interfaces. There are a lot of them in the industry. There are a lot of them in BIAN, and change happens very frequently. That we thought making a CLI to manage the process through to a nice lightweight gateway like Kong makes it so much easier for these smaller application developers and other banks and TPPs, third-party providers, to get involved in this and really be a part of the fintech industry. We're looking for people to help us extend that to other formats, other protocols, and also other standards as well. The aim of the CLI is to make it easier to integrate Kong into your environment with open banking.
So I know we're going to talk a little bit today, and you'll show us, but how Kong Gateway kind of fits into this. But how does Kong add value here over other API management solutions, and where does this fit in?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So Kong is very lightweight in its approach, and through its plug-in nature, you can roll only what you need. And we really support that. It's not a heavyweight north-south gateway. It's a very lightweight east-west gateway. And we think that fits really well with the BIAN solution for creating quick interoperability and API management solutions. And Kong can be quite seamlessly integrated into your existing processes through CI/CD, your security providers, all that sort of thing, very, very simply. So with that in BIAN, we think that this creates a very efficient and cost-effective fast start for organizations looking to integrate to or create interoperability with the banking and finance sector.
Yeah, well, the reason I quite like using Kong is the gateway is just because how unashamedly developer-first it is. A lot of products that we get exposed to aim at what they call citizen integrators, which means everything's done through a GUI, which makes for good demos, but not great developer experiences. And when you try and fit it in with a CI/CD pipeline, it just doesn't work. With Kong, having the management APIs and the deck and the CLI portals, portal CLIs, it means it fits much more nicely in with a proper DevOps attitude, which is something we wanted with the CLI as well. We could have easily just written some ad hoc scripts to do the process, but creating a CLI means that it's something we can include in pipelines in the future as well.
We have a code, not clicks approach to the way we do integration. We feel that Kong shares this value very well as well. So Kong has a very developer-first mentality to it, and everything they do seems to live and breathe this. And that fits really well with our values and where we go as a company. We try and be different by design, and Kong fits in with us through its approach to rolling only what you need into the gateway, and provides a very lightweight, stable, and performant runtime for our customers. When you're developing open banking solutions, having a secure, performant, and reliable gateway is 100% what you need. So this solution goes about implementing our open banking interfaces on Kong, because we feel that the BIAN interfaces on the Kong gateway provide one of the best quick starts that you can have in the financial services and banking industry for creating functionality quickly, effectively, securely, and more importantly, reliably.
And, you know, segueing now into exactly how this works within the banking and finance sector, how can banking and finance companies use this to their advantage?
So maintaining a list of BIAN APIs in a Kong gateway will allow the domains inside the bank to very quickly and efficiently create interoperability with each other. So you're doing that via BIAN, so a standardized architecture in a way and an approach of doing things. This means that you cut down on the amount of rework you're doing, and it means that you are creating a standardized systems infrastructure for externals to integrate to.
Yeah, so Kong Gateway I find to be really good because it's such a lightweight API gateway for the east-west traffic, not such a heavy integration platform. And with that open banking and the BIAN API specifications, it fits in really well because being developer-centric, it allows us to integrate it with our deployment pipelines and pull from the BIAN repository of API specifications and push to the Kong gateway really nicely. And once those specifications are deployed somewhere, we can share these with our third-party consumers so they can go away and build their side of the solution without worrying about the service implementation happening in the background.
And kind of starting to tie this all together, how can banking and finance companies put all this together and use it to their advantage? BIAN, Kong Gateway, the CLI tool, all of it.
So the CLI that we've developed will integrate the BIAN assets and allow you to create those directly in the Kong developer portal. So these are registered directly. And after that point, you can maintain them individually, so on a per interface basis instead of the whole exhaustive list, or in its entirety. This allows you the flexibility of choosing to update only the interfaces that matter to you or to your consumers very quickly and very efficiently. So once it's in there, it really lowers the cost of total cost of ownership of having the Kong Gateway in place and open banking interfaces. Once you've created open banking interfaces and there are consumers on the other end, there can be a high cost to maintaining it from that point. Once you have interfaces, it's very hard to take them away. This allows you to go and maintain the interfaces, create them, delete them as you see fit through a nice and easy to use CLI without having to go through processes and change management and all of that.
Awesome. And for folks who are interested in using and contributing to this, how would they go about that?
Yeah, so it takes away a lot of the hard work using the BIAN standards instead of having to figure out how the interfaces are going to look themselves. They can instead look towards what BIAN have made available and use these interfaces and publish them through their, for example, their Kong developer portal pretty simply. And this allows their people to start working faster. It takes away a lot of the overhead of designing the interfaces and themselves.
And we're about to dive into a demo. You're going to be showing us this in action today. Can you just give us a quick overview of what exactly you'll be demoing today?
Yeah, so what we've put together is the integration between the BIAN repository of API specifications for their service domains with the Kong developer portal. So it allows us to pull from the official repository and push those to publish them to a developer portal so that the consumers can start looking at them. And BIAN have been pretty good with the way they specify their APIs. It follows, you know, the best practices for an API spec. So having the swaggy UI plugin in the Kong portal, they play really nicely together. So the CLI itself is still in the early days. We're looking at extending it to do some more intelligent things like converting these specifications to Kong configuration using the DEX CLI. So we can have the declarative YAML files available. And we can push those to a Kong manager to create our services and routes to have the API gateway itself configured.
Awesome. And I think you're going to walk us through what exactly this looks like. So I'll hand it over to you.
This screen, you might be familiar with the general layout. It's a standard Kong developer portal taken from the template and just branded a little bit with the integration works and the Kong and the BIAN. And so what we want to do is connect to the BIAN repository and deploy an API specification here so we can start advertising that to our consumers. And we've created a command line interface called Kobi. So we had a few goes at naming it, trying to mash together BIAN and Kong. There are a few that were already taken and a few that had unfortunate connotations. So we ended up settling on Kobi for Kong and BIAN. And what it can do is connect to the official BIAN repository of API specifications. So we can do that through the list command, and that just prints out everything that's available on that repository. And as BIAN update this list, Kobi also will be connecting to the latest version. So as they add new API specifications, they'll be available here. And then using Kobi, we can download any one of these to our local computer. So if we wanted to put it into source control for our developer portal specifications, we can do that. That's using the download command. And then we just give it which service domain specification we're interested in, for example, savings account. We can download that here. And then that has downloaded the savings account JSON open API specification file. So all BIAN API specifications are written in JSON. We're looking at extending the Kobi CLI to convert these to YAML if that's the preferred format for people. And Kobi can also deploy an API specification directly from the BIAN repository of specifications through a running Kong developer portal. So that's using the publish subcommand when you need to specify the service you're interested in, for example, a current account, and then which workspace on Kong that the developer portal is running. It's done through the workspace flag. Just tell it where to go. And that deploys the specification directly from BIAN to your developer portal. So if we go back to our developer portal and give it a refresh, we can see that the API specification has come along from BIAN. And if we have a look at it, BIAN have actually been really good at the documentation on their specifications. So they've categorized each operation to the action pattern from the BIAN model. So if we have a look at the different operations available, they include a bit of a blurb on what they're meant to do in the bank, and the message model and code completion and that sort of thing. So using Kobi, we can deploy new specifications from the BIAN repository to our developer portal and share them with our consumers so they can start developing their end of the solution while we look at implementing the actual service itself. And in the future, we'll look at extending Kobi to do things like the declarative configuration, converting the API spec to a YAML file that then can be pushed to a Kong manager and create the Kong artifacts as well. And also look at some service templating, so creating the template of a project to implement the BIAN service itself. So we're looking at collaboration on the CLI, and that'll be available in our public GitHub repository for people to branch and create pull requests as they see fit.
Awesome. Thanks, Jono, for the fantastic demo. And Grant, thanks for joining us today to talk about open banking, BIAN, and Kong Gateway. If you want to learn more, you can visit BIAN.org. And then the CLI tool will be available on the IntegrationWorks GitHub page as well. We'll make sure to include all of these links in the description so you can check them out. Thanks, everyone, for joining us today, and we will see you next time. Thanks to everyone out there for watching. I hope you enjoyed today's episode as much as we enjoyed recording it. Make sure to hit that like button now.
And be sure to subscribe so you don't miss a new episode.
Don't forget to drop us a comment if you have any questions for today's guest or if there's a topic you'd like to see us cover in the future.
And we will see you on the next episode of Kongcast.